have started a new series, and Lisa kind of started it actually last week, called I Want to Be. And over these next few weeks, we're just going to talk about things that we want to become. Lisa talked last week kind of about a second installment of I Want to Be That Girl, and I'm going to talk this week about I Want to Be That Guy. There is a thing inside of me. I hope that it's obvious to the outside, but sometimes I don't know that it is. But there is a passion inside of me that loves to reach other people. As a young man growing up, being a part of youth ministry, and I guess just growing up in the church, I was divinely, I guess you could say, influenced by people in my life who stepped up and influenced me in a positive way, and I never forgot it. As we've been looking here at our ministries, and I've met with Dave Weiniger, who does a great job with our kids' ministries, we were just talking about what can we do to impact in a greater way these kids, especially the fifth and sixth graders, who kind of feel like that they're too old for, you know, kids' church, but not quite old enough for youth group, and they're just kind of in limbo there. What can we do? And Dave implemented having two of our college-age kids, Brooklyn and Mitch Rovang, to come in and help with the fifth and sixth grade kids, to be an influence to them, to be a role model for them, and to just kind of step in so that these kids would have people that they could look up to, because many of our kids don't have adults that will sit and listen to them other than a teacher at school or their parents, or if they're in the principal's office. He usually listens to them real good. But in a positive way, our kids don't have many people who don't have any, you know, dog in the hunt, so to speak, that will just listen to them and take interest in them. And when they experience someone like that, it will change their life. And so Brooklyn and Mitch have been working with these kids. You saw them sitting with them up here, and then they take them back and do some lessons with them in small group type things and communicate and fellowship with them. But here's the thing, and I say this with all the positive in mind. He is ruining these kids. Mitch and Brooklyn are ruining your kids. Do you understand that? Because your kids will now mark Christianity by these two young people. These kids now have the role models in front of them that says, follow me as I follow Christ. And if we could only understand the influence we have of people who are around us, if you could only understand that nothing that you do is in private, it's seen by everyone, good and bad. And that people are watching because people are desperately looking for someone who is the real McCoy when it comes to Christianity, because we've had our fill of fakes. And they're looking for someone who is real. When my kids were young, I'd let them off at the door of either North Intermediate or Haskell Middle School, and I would always say, go make a friend today. And I would always say to my kids, find someone that doesn't have a friend and make him your friend. And over the course of time, my passion has been to find people who don't feel significant and make them significant. And if there's anyone I want to be, is I want to be that guy.
At my school, I am currently enrolled in a building trades class where we go out and build houses. And I'm also enrolled in sports. Sport I like the most is golf. I just got a full ride scholarship to Lewis and Clark for it. For me as a high school student, to carry on a relationship with somebody is probably one of the most important things, because I had an experience in a class with a friend that we got on the subject of religion, and I told him that I'd really didn't like using the word religion because I had a relationship with God. And he kind of asked me more about, you know, what the relationship was. So I told him my background of being a Christian and having a relationship with God. And I asked him, you know, what do you believe? What's your mindset on this? And he actually told me that he was a Wiccan and he believed in the Lord and the Lady, things like that. And it was funny because I just got done watching The Gospel Journey when they had the Wiccan on there. So I knew of a background of what he was coming from, and I knew stuff that I could say and ask him. And so we had about a half an hour of talking through all that, and he told me, you know, man, this is an eye-opener. He goes, God has really sent you to me, you know, so I can realize this. He goes, it's so much better. So we had our next class was actually lunch. Me and him walked outside, sat on a park bench, and I shared my faith. I went over the gospel with him and wound up leading him to Christ, which was the coolest thing ever. Now my friend, he is involved with the youth group, and he's one of my best friends, and we have three classes together this year, so it's nice to have another Christian friend to help share the faith. To be the guy that, you know, God used, it's awesome, because you read that stuff in the Bible, you know, you don't think it's gonna happen to you, and for it to happen to you, it's like, wow, God's really, you know, out there, he really wants to use me.
I want to be that guy. I want to be the guy that responds to opportunity. I want to be the guy that when the time comes that God presents someone to my way and in my path, I have the frame of mind and the wisdom and the knowledge, and I've had the training that I can step in and take advantage of what God has brought in my path. I want to take that opportunity to seize the moment. And God brings within our path those people. He brings those God moments in our life where we might be at a grocery store and we meet someone, or we might be at a gas station, or we might be in our place of employment or at school, and we have these kind of conversations, and instead of running away from it, we know that we can step into it because we can respond with purpose, and we know that we can respond to the opportunities that God brings our way. I want you to know something. God wants people to be saved. And he chooses to use you, listen to me, he chooses to use you to present the gospel to those people in all facets of their life. And so here's the thing, when we're coming to those places in our life where we have those opportunities to meet those people, let me ask you this, are you ready to present the gospel to those people? Is your life ready to present it to them? Or are you spending too much time doing things that don't matter at all? You know what? Here's the thing at church. What we try to do is equip you guys to be ready for these kind of opportunities, for these type of missions. Because when it happens, we need to be ready to seize that moment and have the gospel inside of us so that we can do it. 1 Peter 3:15 says this, but in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. Always be prepared. Everybody look at me right here. Let me see your eyes. Thanks. Always be prepared. Always be ready. Now, what does that mean? That means that I have to study the scripture. I have to know how it is that I can lead someone into the sinner's prayer or talk to someone about Christ. And you know what? It's not just a program that you go through and have five questions and they answer all these questions and you know where to go. No, being a witness to someone is being a witness of what Christ has done in your life. If this was a court of law and we had someone come sit in this seat and we said, we want you to give a witness of something that happened, all you do is tell the truth of the experience that happened to you. That's what being a witness for Christ is. Just tell the account of how Christ saved you, of what happened in your life, that your life was changed or transformed, what the process was. And when you can do that, you will be equipped to be able to touch someone's life. Why? Because you may not have all the right words to say or know the right words to say, but let me tell you, God will ordain it. He'll put the words in your mouth. He'll work the situations out. It will go beyond your intellect, your ability, your knowledge, and it will go into another realm. God needs open vessels that will be willing to seize the opportunity when the opportunity comes. One of the greatest joys I had in high school was being able to be a witness to the kids who were on campus that I was around. And even to this day, I see kids that I went to high school, well, Okay, I see adults, all right? I'm not a kid anymore. It's kind of hard to understand that, but once you pass 50, you can't call yourself a kid anymore, just for you to know. But I see guys today that I went to high school with, and occasionally they will make comments about things that happened or things that they saw or influences that we had when we were on the other people that we didn't even hardly know them in high school. And I told you guys the story. I saw a young man at, at Bass Pro during the Christmas season, and I hadn't seen him since we were fairly young. And we talked and threw around some names and how's so-and-so doing and how's this person doing. And this kid, he grew up a year ahead of me. He was in a lot of the same sports that I was in, had a lot of the same friends. He was also a pastor's son. And so as I was coming through school, whenever they'd find out I was a preacher's kid, they would say, oh, yeah, we know about preacher's kid. We know Jimmy Don. That was his name. Well, that's not all what preacher's kids are like. Well, we know what preacher's kids are like. And as time went by, I was the good kid, and he was kind of the rebel kid and got involved in a lot of crazy things. After a few marriages and a few issues with the law and different things that he went through in his life, I saw him some years later. And in our conversation, he paused and said to me, he said, you know what? You and the guys that you hung around with were always the guy that I needed to be. He said, all my friends, we wouldn't admit it, but we all admired you guys for the stance that you took. And he said, you were the Christian that I should have been in high school. And, you know, here's what we don't understand sometimes. It may be cool to be the popular person. It may be cool to have all the stories told about you and all the stuff that you have done. It might be cool, but I want you to know something. There's always someone out there that is cooler. There's always someone out there that parties harder. There's always someone out there that gets more girls. There's always someone out there that does crazier stuff. Always. You can never be the craziest, wildest, most idiotic person. But when it comes to God, you can be the wildest, craziest Christian. You can set yourself apart by loving God and not falling to the pitfalls of life. Well, we're not having any fun as Christians. Well, you know what? We do give up a lot of fun, but we also give up a lot of things that aren't fun. We also give up a lot of hangovers. We give up a lot of problems. We give up a lot of hurt feelings. We give up a lot of broken relationships and broken hearts through the process. When you're that person, it makes all the difference in the world. Let me keep going. Number two is the story I want to tell you about, the story of Jim Elliot. Jim Elliot was a missionary who went to the Aka Indians down in South America in 1955. Jim graduated from Wheaton College at the time. Him and four other men, the Lord put it upon their heart to go into an unreached people group in South America and tell them of the gospel. This group of Indians were noted specifically for their viciousness and their cruelty. Most of the people who came in to try to help them, they would kill them. The government had even come in to try to help them, and they killed those people. And so they were kind of at a point with these Aka Indians that they didn't know whether they should just come in with military and take them out, or if there was some other hope that they could have for them. And so Jim Elliot and four other men decided, the Lord had put upon their heart, that they were going to reach these people. And so they began to do ministry and pray about how they can do it. Over a several week period of time, one of the men had an airplane. And they would come in and they would fly a tight circle around the main part of this village with a basket on a rope. And they would lower that basket down with gifts to the people, with pictures of themselves, with trying to let the people know that they're there to help. They would give them gifts. They would give them food. They were doing everything they could to try to win these people, to let them know that they loved them and that they cared for them in a language that they didn't understand. Over several week period of time, they came by and they would drop these gifts. They would do this kind of stuff. And finally, the time came when the men came to the river that was close to where these Indians, their village was, and they landed on a beach with their airplane, landed on a beach next to this river. And from that process, as the people came to them, they began to make friends with them and give them gifts and help them and befriend them, all in hopes of winning them ultimately to Christ. One day the men of the village came to the five missionaries who were on the beachfront, and instead of being friendly, they were hostile this time. And they came with their spears and their bows and arrows, and they killed those men, those five missionary men. They killed them, and they left them right there on the beach. Their wives were in a town close by, civilized area, and they were keeping in contact through radio. And when the men didn't respond over a period of time, they knew something was wrong. And so they brought another airplane in. And when they flew through that valley, they saw on that riverbank those five men who had been killed and were now laying on that beach. And they came in and they rescued what they could and got the stuff and material and brought the men out and had a burial for them. But in an unbelievable display of compassion and love, these women, still feeling the call of God to minister to these Indians, they now begin to go in and minister to these Indians to tell them, you killed my husband, but Jesus still loves you. And over the course of time, these women with the anointing of the Holy Spirit came in and began to make converts through these Indians and won them to Christ, not only the villages to Christ, but also the men who had killed their husbands, they won to Christ. And Jim Elliot's life was so dramatic. I can remember as a young boy, my mom would read to us as we were on our way on trips on Colorado or wherever, and she would read to us Beyond the Gates of Splendor. And I remember that story of Jim Elliot coming into this area. Beyond the Gates of Splendor was a book that was written about him that had many of his diaries in it that talked about his stance and what he believed in. And there was such passion in his belief that he was going to make a difference, because as a young man, God had called him into missions, and because of that, it had so affected and impacted his life that his whole life mission was to do something for God. And he realized that it may not be long that he lives. He may not live a long period of time, but the time that he lives, he wants it to be fruitful and to be meaningful. Jim Elliot made a couple of quotes that I was reading through some of his stuff, and they stuck out to me. Here's one of the quotes he made, and he wrote down, Father, make me a crisis man. Bring those I contact to a decision. Let me not be a milepost on a single road. Make me a fork that when men turn one way or another on facing Christ, that men must turn one way or another on facing Christ in me. Another one that he made that's quite famous, probably his most popular and famous quote, that says, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. Jim Elliot was willing to give everything for the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, popularity, fame, the fortunes and the comforts of this life were not his main emphasis and were not the goal of his life, but the goal of his life was to present Christ to people who, in other words, would never hear the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to be that man. I want to be that guy. I want to be the guy that responds to purpose. I want to be the guy that has the Lord speak to me, and I am willing and available to move out on what he wants for my life and what he wants me to do. I want to be the person that lives beyond myself and lives for a greater cause and a greater purpose, and that purpose is the cause of Jesus Christ. I want my life to count. I want my life to matter. When I die, I care nothing about them saying that I had this much money or I had this many things or my corporation or my church was this big or that big. I care nothing about that. All I care about is that when I die, there are people that say, he led me to Christ. He told me of the goodness of God. If it had not been for his influence and his relationship with me, I would not be where I'm at today, because that's what Christ asked of us. Whether you're the prettiest or the best looking or the most popular will never change anything. The only thing that makes a difference in this life is what I do for God. I don't care that I'm popular. I don't care that I'm respected. I want to be significant in people's lives. I want to be that guy. I want to respond to the purpose that God puts within my life. I want to show you another video this morning. It's a song that was written and composed specifically for this missionary. There's another movie that probably you guys have made. A friend of ours, Mark Green, produced it, put it together, called The End of the Spear. Maybe some of you guys saw it. And this is a song that was written, and at the end of the song, you're going to hear a guy in the background chanting. And it's not weird. We don't understand it because it's in a different language, but listen to me. The guy who's in the background is chanting is actually the man who killed Jim Elliot back in the 50s. Since then, he has given his heart to the Lord. And in this video here in the background, he is chanting, but he's chanting praises to God and glory to God through the song. I want you to listen to this as we watch.
Man of courage, with your message of peace, what is that look in your eyes? Why have you come to this faraway place? What is this story you would lay down your life to tell? What kind of love can this be? There is no greater love than there. There is no greater gift that can ever be given. To be willing to die so another might live. There is no greater love than this. This is the love that God showed.
Are you sensing the same thing that I'm sensing in my life, that I want to be that guy? I want to be that person that makes a difference. I want to be the person that responds to the opportunity, that responds to purpose. And the last one is, I want to be the guy that responds to passion. There are so many stories in the Bible of men with great passion. As I went through the scriptures, I found lots of different stories, and I went back to one that you guys will know well because you heard it as a child, and it's the story of David and Goliath. David was a young man who grew up in the desert, tending sheep. He was the youngest of all of his brothers, and he was the most insignificant of his brothers, and they sent him out to tend the sheep. But yet David, while he was out there, he didn't take that time to moan and groan about the situations that he was in, but he took that time to reflect on God and to worship God and to listen to the Spirit of God. And through that process, he wrote songs. There were encounters that he had with wild animals to protect the sheep, and he gained wisdom and knowledge and a power, and maybe even his naiveness was of benefit to him. Because when it came time for him to go visit his brothers, it maybe was naiveness that stood up to a giant. It was maybe his naiveness that said, I'm not going to stand for this. Maybe he didn't know what the ramifications were, but thank God he wasn't giving in to his naivete. But he was willing to stand up for his principle and for the passion that God put inside of him. I love the story, and I've told it several times, of how the Israelites would come out and the Philistines would come out, and every day they would get all their armor on and they would come out to face each other. And they would stand there, and the Israelites would listen to the threats of the Philistines, and finally Goliath would come out, and he was huge. He stood taller than everybody else, and he would throw his insults out at the Israelites, and it would make them scared, and they'd go back to their place and they'd take all their armor off and they'd talk about how tomorrow's going to be different. Man, we are going to go out there and we are going to clean their clock tomorrow. The next day they put on all their armor, they went out, they did the same thing. They went through the process, no change, no difference, get up, go fight, get up, go fight, get up, go fight, day after day after day. It may seem like you're going to church on Sunday morning sometime. Maybe like you're going to work sometimes. You're wondering, what's the point, what's the reason that I'm doing all this? But then this little boy named David comes in and he hears the threats of Goliath. And there was something inside of him that snapped, something that a passion in him that rose up. He didn't take into consideration how small he was, how inexperienced he was, or how young he was. The only thing he took into consideration was that man, that uncircumcised Philistine, as the scriptures say, is saying things against my God, the God of Israel, and I am not standing for it, because he understood that it wasn't by his abilities or his talents or his experience that he was going to do anything, but it is only by the power of God that resided inside of him. Now David began to say, hey, I'm going to do that. And his brothers even rebuked him. What are you doing? You're out here trying to embarrass us, telling us that you're going to go out here and fight this guy and wanting to know what the reward is going to be. How can you embarrass us like this? You just need to quit. Did our father send you out here to embarrass us? And he's getting this pressure from not only people who are around him, but family members are telling him, you're crazy for doing this. How can you stand up for something that you don't even know that you can do? You're just trying to make us look bad. Even as he stood before King Saul, and King Saul said, take my armor and put it up on you. Take my ways. Take my provision. Go out there in my authority. And David said, listen, this isn't working for me. I can't even hold this armor up. And David knew it wasn't this armor that's going to protect me, but it's one thing, it's the power of God. And it's not this armor that's going to help me defeat the Goliath and the enemies of my life and the giants of my life. But only the power of God can do it. And so David went and fought the biggest foe, the biggest giant that Israel had ever faced, the biggest obstacle, the biggest thing in his life, and in the lives of those people. David was willing to face it. And not only that, David did face it. Scripture says that he went out and he picked up 5 stones. I'm not really sure why he picked up 5 stones. Dr. Igblad is here. If you'd like to know the answer, I'm sure he probably has it. But I don't know it. I think maybe he picked up 5 stones in case he missed with the first one. He had 4 more shots. It's as good as your guess. Some people say that he had five stones because Goliath had four other brothers, or they killed them later. They didn't need stones to do that. But he picked up five stones, and he took that stone and put it in a sling, and he let it go. And I want you to know something. It wasn't that David was a great shot, that he was an expert at that. I'm sure those stones had different aerodynamic abilities. That wasn't that. You're missing the point. But when he took that stone up under the power of God and he told Goliath, he said, "You come against me with the sword and the spear and the javelin, but I come against you by the Lord of hosts of the armies of Israel." And he took the sling and he threw it in the air and threw that stone, and it found its mark, and he hit him right in the middle of the head, and it killed him. And that day, Israel had a great defeat. But greater than that, that day, God had a great victory. Not because he killed Goliath, but because now all of Israel in all of eternity, all of us now can look back and see what God can do through the life of one person, through the life of one person who chooses to hear God's voice and respond to what God is saying. I want to be that guy. I want to be that guy. I want to be that guy that responds to passion, that knows that nothing is impossible for a person who has God on their side. That's the desire of my life. Listen, David was the most common of all of his brothers, yet David was the one who made the difference. And I don't know what your excuse is this morning. I don't know what you're saying about why you can't do something for God. I have a feeling it comes down to want to. I have a feeling it comes down to, can I do it? I have a feeling it comes down to, is it more important than my PlayStation? Or is it more important than my texting? Or is it more important than the movie I'm watching? Or listen to this, is me changing the heart of another person through the love of Christ more important than the friends that I choose to hang around with? Let me tell you something. I don't want to scare you here, but your friends are only as deep as the fun you have with them. When the fun leaves, your friends will leave. Can I get a witness in here this morning? Anybody has ever gone through that in your life? You thought your friends were the greatest thing in the world and they would stand behind you the rest of your life, but when adversity comes and when the fun stops and when they leave to go home for college or for the summer or whatever happens, all of a sudden you understand that your next friends are only a drink away. All of a sudden you understand that my friends are only interested in what I can do for them. They're only interested in my having a good time with them. But when the good times are over, there's no one there. The only people I can count on are family. The only people I can count on are the people who are in my life and stay in my life and are connected to me through the power of God. We are the family of God. And I want to be that man. I want to be that guy who makes a difference in the world that goes beyond just good times. That it's a difference that will stick to you through good times and bad times, through sickness, through health. It will be there the whole time. And that's the power of God. And there is no drink, there is no drug that can equal the power of God and what he can do in your life. There is no relationship that's more important than the power of God. I want to be that guy. I want to be the person who changes the world through my relationship. I want to be the one who has the wisdom of God inside of me, and I can project that and portray that to the people who are in my life. I want to be used by God in everything that I do. And I hope that that is your desire this morning. You know, sometimes I scratch my head and I just wonder, is what I'm saying sinking into hearts? You know, I wish we had a black church here. They respond back to you. You know, it's immediate gratification. When you say something, either they get it or they don't, you know? And they'll tell you if they get it or they don't. If they don't get it, they'll just sit there and shake their head or say, try again, you know, keep it coming. You know, whatever, at least I know. Y'all people are just so quiet. I'm not even sure if you're still out there. The lights are down. I can't see the clock. So don't leave them down. That's fine. I know some smart eye's going to throw the spotlight up on the clock real quick. But folks, I want to know that the passion of my life is seeping through to become the passion of your life. Pastor, are you so arrogant that you think that everybody ought to mimic you? No, I'm not. I've got a lot of things I don't want you to mimic. But I am so arrogant to believe that what God is doing is worth mimicking. And what God can do through your life is worth mimicking. We use Brooklyn and Mitch to talk about kids who are making a difference. Those are two people who are making a difference in the lives of your kids, and you will see it, and some of you already have. Let me ask you this. That's two college kids who are making a difference in people's lives. Let me ask you this. What could you do with your life? Who could you make a difference in? We've got our high school kids up here. Gentry's getting ready to go off into college, which just scares me to death. I know it does her parents too, but you know what, Gentry, when you go to your new college, don't view that as a scary new world that you got to find your way to fit in. Don't view it as that. View it as a new mission field that you can go. You feel God's called you to India? Let Him first call you to the college you're going to. Let Him first call you to be an influence to those people there. Because let me tell you, if you can go on that college campus and make a difference, it's the training that you need to be able to go to India to make a difference too. God wants you. Whatever your excuse is this morning, remember, David was the least of his family, had the least abilities. He was smaller than everybody else and went to fight the greatest enemy of known to man at that time, with no armor, with only a slingshot, but he went under the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is nothing that you can't do. There is no person that you can't influence. There is no heart that is impenetrable when it comes to the power of God. Here's the thing. Will you go and be that person? Will you go and be that man? Will you go and be that girl? Be that guy? Will you go and do it? If you will, God will use you mightily. I want to be that man. Lord Jesus, Father, this morning, my prayer is that this message goes beyond my words. It communicates to the hearts of these people. Father, you so desperately want people to mobilize themselves through your power to go into the world and make a difference. There is not an auditorium that could house or seat the people that could be affected by this congregation leaving this week and going out and making a difference in the lives of the people who they are coming in contact with. Whether it's through witnessing to another friend in class at school, or whether it's through feeling the call and hearing the call to go on a mission field and win to Christ an unreached people group, or whether it's like David to understand his limitations and his abilities, but yet to stand up to the largest enemy that we could ever imagine through the power of God in his life. Nothing is impossible for you, Lord Jesus. And Father, I just ask through your power, God, my words are empty and worthless without the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Father, with your anointing upon these words, it will penetrate and cut to the quick of hearts, and it will change lives. And Father, that's what I pray. I pray, Lord, that some things that were said this morning came directly from your heart to the hearts of these people here. And Father, my prayer is that you would immobilize people and put a desire and a fire inside of their lives that they cannot get out. And Lord, they will be willing to step out and become that man and that woman, that guy and that girl to a lost generation who is on its way to hell unless someone does something and stands up to make a difference in someone's life. God, I pray that it starts with this congregation. God, I pray that these words are not empty. I pray that someone within this congregation would take this to heart and would make a difference in the world this week, in their families, in their work. God, let someone be willing to step out in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, to be your hand extended to the world. Services like this that I want to go into hell with a water gun. You know, I mean, it just, I am so tired. I'm feeling like the world is winning and the church is losing. So tired of seeing our kids get involved in things and do things that we know that are detrimental, but they refuse to listen to us. So tired of hearing about more sickness, more problems. So tired of hearing about all the stuff that goes on in our world. It makes me want to lock my doors and buy a gun and just hibernate. Folks, I want you guys to know something. At some point, some of you got to get so fed up with the way it is. Here's the hard understanding. Everybody listen to this. For some of you, you are not going to listen. Your heart is hardened. You know the way of salvation. You're what the scripture talks about. It has a form of godliness but denies its power. All of the love, all of the everything is not going to penetrate your life because you're inoculated to it. You resist all of it. And let me tell you something. You are going to go down a path that is going to be painful and destructive and harmful. And don't you ever blame God for the things that you're getting ready to go through. Because God sends family members and church members and everybody else to try and rescue you because we love you with passion. We love you with passion. But if you refuse to turn towards God, then God will get your attention one way or the other. And I thank God for the grace of God that loves you so much that He doesn't give up on you. But like my grandma used to say, when little boys don't listen, they have to feel. And sometimes we are going to go through processes in our life when we don't listen. We've got to experience it. But God, out of His passion and love, loves you so much that He wants to bring you back to Him. Who is going to go? Who is going to make a difference? Who is going to be that man and that woman? Who is going to be that person that says, I'm willing to go. I'm willing to go to India if need be, or to Africa, or in the mission field. I'm willing to go back to my school and make a difference. I'm willing to go and try to recoup that relationship with my neighbors. I'm willing to go and try to restore the relationship with my family, with my sons and daughters who want nothing to do with religion, who have gone their way. I'm willing to do whatever. I want to be that man and that woman. Who is willing to do that? Who? We got one, and then we got one standing. Is that it? Out of this congregation, we got two people who are willing to do it. Don't stand because everybody else is, all right? Be honest to yourself. Give us a picture of the lostness of humanity. Give us a glimpse of the devastation that awaits for those people who choose not to follow you. Give us a glimpse of what our family is going to go through, what our friends are going through and may go through. Give us a glimpse, Lord Jesus, of the destruction that's out there. And Lord, let it be the thing that motivates us to understand that nothing else in this world matters except Christ. Nothing else matters except being able to take the word and the gospel and the witness of Jesus to the world. Let it start within my family, and let it go then to my neighbors and to my town, and venture out from there. God, we can't just sit and let the world pass by while we enjoy another television program or play another video game. There are people who so desperately are looking for the way, and we lock ourselves inside our churches and want to worship you and want to know why you're not moving in our lives. Maybe it is, Lord, that you've moved out of the church into the community and we were the ones that weren't willing to follow you. Father, I pray for this congregation, for those who are standing and even for those who don't. Set a fire down in our soul, Lord Jesus, that we can't control it. We can't predict it. We can't tell when it's going to come. But Lord, when you come upon us, we have the wisdom and the knowledge and the boldness to step out and love the unlovely, to reach the unreachable, and to do the miraculous through the name and the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, let these people who have stood, let it sink inside of their lives. I pray that they wouldn't be able to sleep until they get a clear vision of what you want them to do. And Father, let us go into the world and make a difference. I refuse to sit here, soak and sour in these pews. That is not the outcome of my life. It is not the direction that I wish to go, or my family, or these church people to go. But Father, let us be bold and step out and make a difference in this world and celebrate the goodness of God. The reason our church is empty at times is because we lack the boldness and the authority to go out into the highways and the byways and tell people of the goodness of God. If they knew the goodness of God, if we understood the goodness of God, there would be no auditorium that could house these people, because of their going out and telling people that goodness, and people would want to come to experience that goodness. But Father, it has to start inside of me. It has to start inside of these people. So Father, I pray that you burn it inside of us in Jesus' precious name. Lord, as we leave this place this morning, as we leave this auditorium, let us go into the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And Father, I pray that your Spirit would be residing in us and people would sense it. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. I love you guys. Man, I love it when you guys do stuff like that. I love it. And I know I push your buttons a little bit, but I love it. I want to live my life with people like this. Let's go and make a difference. I realize that may have made some of you late to baccalaureate and things, but let's go and make a difference. Go and make a difference in your world. God bless you guys. Thanks for being a part of our service this morning.